Good morning. It's time to begin our worship services. We want to welcome you. If you're visiting with us, we're especially glad that you're here. If you're joining us online, we're glad that you've joined us. We'll begin getting signals from the back. Okay, we'll begin right now. We're going to ask John Knight to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Holy God, thank you so much for this opportunity to come together and worship you this morning, study your word, sing songs of praises unto you. We're so thankful for each and every day that we have in this world to try and do some good and follow your word and bring your word into this world and be a light where we can. And Father, we ask now that you would be with us and help us to keep our minds focused on the lessons that have been prepared. Help our hearts to sing out loudly and praise you in song. And we pray that we would stay focused this morning on the reason why we're here, that being to worship and praise you, accept you into our lives, that we may bring you into this world and show this world that we are light and that you are the right way and you are the one and only and true God and the creator of us all. And Father, we thank you so much for the word that you've given us and how it guides us and leads us in our lives. And thank you so much for your son, his sacrifice for us. Pray all this in Christ's most holy name. Amen.
Good morning. The scripture reading for today is 1 John 2, 22 to 29. Again, it's 1 John 22 to 29, sorry. For John's readers, false prophets, teachers were a real problem. Today's reading shows how the church John wrote had a spiritual gift. He called an anointing in verse 27. And with the help of spiritual gifted brethren, they could walk in church. Sorry. Again, open your Bibles to John 21st John 22 to 29. Please stand. Who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is an antichrist, he who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. Let what you have heard from the beginning abide in you. If what you have heard from the beginning abides in you, then you too will abide in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he has made to us, eternal life. I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you, but the anointing that you receive from him abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about everything and is true and in no lie, just as it has taught you, abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, so that when he appears, we might have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of him. Please have a seat.
I just wanted to see y'all sit down and then have y'all stand back up. We'll sing, "We Praise Thee, O God." Sing first three verses of the song.
Also, we praise thee, O God, for the Son of our God, for Jesus, who died and is now on above. Hallelujah, thank the glory. Hallelujah, amen.
Good morning, good morning. My Bible is open to 2 Samuel chapter 6, and I need you to turn your Bible there as well. We'll be in 2 Samuel 6 for the entirety of this lesson, and we need to be thinking carefully through this text and reading this text to best be able to wrap our heads around what's going on. Let's just start right in the text. This is 2 Samuel chapter 6 and in verse 5. I'm so glad that you're here this morning. If you're joining us online, we're glad that you are joining us via technology. Good crowd here already this morning. Good things happening as we worship the Lord together. In 2 Samuel 6 and verse 5, David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error. He died. He died there beside the ark of God. Now, there's a long list of things that I don't understand. For example, why can't we do that daylight savings time fallback thing every Saturday night and get an extra hour of sleep? That seems wonderful. Why is it when I heat a piece of pizza in the oven, in the microwave oven, one end of the pizza is roughly the temperature of lava, and the other end of the pizza is roughly the temperature of the South Pole? And why is it when you're running late to church, you can't make a single red light? I mean, every one of them catches you. There's a long list of things I don't understand, and I would include 2 Samuel 6 on that list. Why did God kill Uzzah? This is an amazing chapter. It's part of a trilogy. 2 Samuel 5, 6, and 7 all go together. And in 2 Samuel 5, David takes Jerusalem, cleans it out of the folks there, and makes it his capital. In 2 Samuel 6, David ultimately gets the ark to Jerusalem. And then in 2 Samuel 7, David plans to build a temple to God in Jerusalem. It's a Jerusalem trilogy. And it is a time of great rejoicing. David is establishing his capital. We've had that bad, bad king Saul, who just did everything wrong as fast as he could possibly do it. Now David is the right king. He is a man after God's own heart, and things are going extraordinarily well. In the middle of that, David is saying, let's bring the ark of God all the way to the capital. And there are 30,000 people marching in this parade. And it is a joyous occasion, and things are magnificent, and they're worshiping God, and it's just wonderful. And then disaster strikes. Call 911. Uzzah is laying in the road, and he's dead. David is angry, and as if there's not enough things to wonder about in 2 Samuel 6, in a minute, his wife makes fun of him. What is that all about? So there's just a bunch here in 2 Samuel 6 that is difficult to understand as we try to bring the ark into Jerusalem. This morning, I want us to focus on 2 Samuel 6, particularly the puzzling incident with Uzzah. Why does God strike him dead? He seems to be doing the right thing. After all, Uzzah's only trying to help. Was he supposed to let the Ark of the Covenant fall off the cart, bounce on the road? Why didn't God cut him some slack here? I want to better understand what's going on in 2 Samuel, the 6th chapter, and I want to know what to take away from this chapter, so that instead of angering God, as these people did here, we can please God in all that we do, but particularly in our worship this morning. Got your Bible ready? Let's work on 2 Samuel chapter 6. Verse 1, please. David, again, gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God. If we are going to understand this text, we will need to know some things about the Ark of the Covenant. Actually, the Ark has not been mentioned in Samuel for quite some time. There are a couple of obscure references, but the last time the Ark of the Covenant was really centerpieced in Samuel, it's in 1 Samuel 4. In 1 Samuel chapter 4, the Israelites carry the Ark of God into battle against the Philistines, and if you recall, They lose the ark in that battle. The Philistines take it from them because they defeat them in battle. And there are some things that that helps us understand. For example, the ark is in fact very, very special. But there is no power in the ark in and of itself. It is a golden box, but it in no way emanates its own power. And the Israelites make that mistake in 1 Samuel 4. If we just have the box, we are invincible. And that, of course, is not the case at all. By the way, David, later on in 2 Samuel, will illustrate that he understands this, that the ark has no value in and of itself, that it is only special because God is enthroned on the ark. That's important to know. Let me finish verse 2. David arose with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. I want to step out of Samuel for a moment. We'll read a couple of other passages. Turn with me over to Chronicles in 1 Chronicles chapter 28. In 1 Chronicles chapter 28, it's verse 2 that helps our understanding here, because in 1 Chronicles 28 and 2, King David rises to his feet and says, 1 Chronicles 28, 2, "Hear me, my brothers, and my people, I had it in my heart to build a house of rest for the ark of the covenant of the Lord, for the footstool of our God. And I made preparations for that building." Again, in the Psalms now, in Psalm 99. In Psalm 99 and in verse 1, there the text tells us, "The Lord reigns," Psalm 99, 1. "The Lord reigns, let the people tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake." In a very real way, the ark was much more than just a box. Those angels, the cherubim that were on the lid of the box, represent God's throne upon this earth. God's presence is with the Israelite people. Where does the king sit? Where is God's throne? The answer is the Ark of the Covenant is that throne. And of course, while it is God's throne, it is also even more than that. It is the place where God met Moses, Exodus 25 tells us. And furthermore, what was in the Ark? In the Ark was the Ten Commandments. And on top of that, what did they use the Ark for? On the Day of Atonement, once a year, the high priest went into the very most holy place in the tabernacle, later the temple, and sprinkled blood on those cherubim, on the throne of God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. So someone has noticed that in one place, you have God's rulership, his throne, you have God's reconciliation, the blood and the Day of Atonement, and you have God's revelation, the Ten Commandments were inside. If you can't make a sermon out of 3 hours like that, I don't know what you could do. It's an amazing piece of furniture. It is a very special piece of furniture. And the more we understand that, the better we are equipped to get what's going on in 2 Samuel 6. Because nobody just grabs the throne. You just don't do that. Last summer, Dean and I were on a wonderful, wonderful trip in the British Isles, and we'd made the rounds in London, and we went to Westminster Abbey. And you know, there's lots of cool stuff to see in Westminster Abbey, but among the coolest things to see there is the coronation chair. The coronation chair is this rather plain-looking, wooden, big, throny-looking thing that every king and queen in England has sat on to be anointed and coronated as the monarch over the United Kingdom since 1296. Built into the chair is a huge slab of stone from Scotland, known as the Stone of Destiny, and all of this is just laden with history. So many kings and queens have sat upon that chair. It is a very unique piece of furniture, and guess what? You can't sit in it. And I couldn't either. It's behind glass. When you have something that special, you don't let people like Mark Roberts just come and kind of just nestle down in it. "Oh, look, I brought my pocket knife. Maybe I'll just, I'll just carve my initials in the arm." No, no, no. It's the coronation chair. It is a special, special chair in England's history. And that doesn't begin to approach how important the Ark of the Covenant is. In fact, it is so special that there were all kinds of rules about how you transport this thing. It was always to be carried. Always. Numbers, the seventh chapter, talks about that. There's no provision made for putting it on a cart. This is the kind of cart, a cart overlaid with gold, being drawn by white horses. No. There's no conversation of that at all. There were rings in the corner of the Ark of the Covenant and long poles. It was always to be carried by the priests. And when you think about it, that's how kings and royalty were transported in that day. They were transported on those, it's called a sedan chair. And the king is up here, and they're all carrying the king. And so the king's throne is carried that way. And it is only carried by one specific clan of the Levite tribe, the Kohathites. They're in charge of carrying it. It's their job. That's what they did. And no one is ever to touch it. The Kohathites are even warned specifically, you have this special and unique job. Don't touch the ark. The holy and sacred chest is not to be disrespected. God isn't to be disrespected by somebody just putting their hands on it. So the more we know about that, the more we're equipped to operate with 2 Samuel chapter 6. And as I turn back to 2 Samuel chapter 6, and I'm looking there at verse 1, David gathered all the men together, and there are 30,000 there that are gathered. Interestingly, when the ark was lost in battle in 1 Samuel 4, 30,000 men perished. So now there's some symmetry there as 30,000 are gathered in this massive parade to celebrate bringing the ark of God into Jerusalem. However, I would call your attention to what's missing in the text. Where's the praying? In David's life, when David does what David wants to do without consulting God, usually that goes badly. And this is a good illustration of that. David regularly consults God. And when he consults God and asks God what to do, God tells him. In fact, in 2 Samuel 5, look at verse 23. God has been consulted even in battle plans. Do we attack? How do we attack? What do we do? And God tells David everything that he needs to know. But in 2 Samuel 6, there is no word at all that David said to the Lord, we're taking the ark to Jerusalem. Is that a good idea? Should we do that? How should we do that? Surely the Lord would have reminded David of the important parts of how to transport this special throne of God. And so as we begin to work through 2 Samuel 6, here's how this chapter breaks down. Let's read together. David gathered the chosen men, 30,000, verse 1. David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, note the emphasis, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. Lord of hosts is kind of church language. One translation renders that, bears the name of the Lord of heaven's armies. And another translation lists it, the Lord Almighty. Lord of hosts is an expression for the armies of heaven. And it is a power expression. It speaks of God Almighty who commands the armies of heaven. They carried, verse 3, the ark of God on a new cart. They brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving this new cart with the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. This looks like how the Philistines transported the ark. They put it on a cart to send it back to Israel. Are we doing things like the nations around us? Are we adapting pagan ways of doing things? And I would say again, the ark was never to be put on a cart. It was always to be carried. In this culture, you put stuff on a cart. People are carried. Stuff you load on a wagon. One scholar noted here, this would be like picking your grandparents up at the airport and you put their suitcases in the car and then you go around the back and you pop the trunk and you say to grandma, get in. That's completely wrong. Grandma rides inside. You put the suit. What are we doing? So if we know about the ark and we know how special it is and we know how it's to be transported and how it's not to be transported, by the time I've got to verse 4, I am shaking my head. This is all wrong. We are not doing what pleases God. This is a mistake. Everything about this looks bad, which reminds us we always need to obey God. We always need to obey God. Even when we are trying to please God, that doesn't mean we get to throw God's rules out the window. One writer said, the account is realistic in portraying eager enthusiasm, but alongside it, a perilous disregard for the holiness of God. We need to focus on that. Just because we're all fired up about something being special and important and we're doing this for God and oh, this is amazing, doesn't mean we discard what Scripture teaches us about how to approach God. David's enthusiasm for the project seems to have gotten in the way of paying attention to the requirements of God's law. Just because we're fired up doesn't mean we discard what God tells us to do. And I should say here, these things aren't mutually exclusive. They could have had a great celebration of God. They could have worshiped God while the priest carried it appropriately and according to the law. Just because they had a bunch of priests there carrying the ark the way it was supposed to be carried wouldn't have ruined the parade. They could have done it right. But instead, verse 5, as David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, as they were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals, when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God. He took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error. He died there beside the ark of God. The term error there only occurs in this place in the Old Testament. It is a term that some translations render irreverence, but in other cultures outside of the Bible, that term is used to mean disdain. Disdain. We think of Uzzah as doing the right thing. I'm going to save it, but maybe that isn't the sense of this at all. Everything about this is wrong. Uzzah does not seem to have had the right kind of reverence. And of course, this text is very troubling to a lot of people, and there's lots of conversation about what happened here. I read an amazing discussion about how the ark was a wooden chest overlaid inside and outside with gold, and as such, it functioned as a static electricity collector. And while it was bumping along the rocky road, it produced enough electricity to electrocute Uzzah when he touched it. That is an amazingly creative understanding of what goes on there. And it's wrong. It's dead wrong. What the text says is, God struck him down. That's what happened, and that's what we need to know. God struck him. David was, verse 8, angry because the Lord had broken out against Uzzah. This place is called Perez Uzzah to this day. The Lord broke out in chapter 5 in verse 20 against the Philistines. Now the Lord breaks out against Uzzah. We are reminded here that the holiness of God is not just reserved for pagan people. The holiness of God is reserved for all who disdain the Lord. We're not certain about David's anger here. Is David angry at himself because we didn't do it right? Is David angry with God? I'm not certain about all of that. But in verse 10, David was not willing to take the ark of the Lord into the city of David. David took it aside into the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. So here we have the realization that we've done something terribly wrong. We just need to stop. We just need to stop and figure this out. We're going to have to stop and reset. But in the middle of all of that, it becomes clear that the wages of sin is death. It is incredible to me what people do to try to explain what happened to Uzzah, including very fanciful and far-fetched discussions of static electricity collectors. Wow, that is way out there. There's no need for us to come up with crazy solutions like that. What we need to see is that the wages of sin is death. Uzzah broke God's law. He died. That's what happens when you break God's law. We don't need to find something big enough in our eyes to justify God striking Uzzah down. What we need to realize is that touching God's throne, violating God's law, putting your hand on the ark of God was a sin. That's enough. God said, don't do that. Uzzah did it. Uzzah died. We need to retrain ourselves. Instead of looking at 2 Samuel 6 and judging God, we need to retrain ourselves to see sin the way God sees sin. What we ought to do is judge David and Uzzah and everyone else, rather than trying to cover for this embarrassing mistake that God made. God did not make the mistake. David and Uzzah made the mistake. And so verse 12 tells us that the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite for 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. It was told King David, the Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom, all that belongs to him, because of the ark of God. So David went up and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with rejoicing. Now, again, I need to step out of the 2 Samuel 6 account and move over to 1 Chronicles 15. This is an excellent passage to write in the margin of 2 Samuel 6. Because it gives us a little bit more insight about what happened. After 3 months, David said, hey, we can do this. And 1 Chronicles 15 explains how that worked and how they were able to do that. Because in 1 Chronicles 15 and verse 12, David says there, 1 Chronicles 15 and 12, he says to a number of the priests, notice that nothing is said of Uzzah being a priest. We're not certain of his lineage, but doesn't seem to have been a Kohathite. Now, 1 Chronicles 15:11, David summoned the priests Zadok and Abiathar, and then these Levites, and he said unto them, verse 12, you're the heads of the fathers' houses of the Levites. Consecrate yourselves, you and your brothers, so that you may bring up the ark of the Lord, the God of Israel, to the place that I have prepared for it, because you did not carry it the first time. The Lord our God broke out against us because we did not seek him according to the rule. David got it, didn't he? We blew it. We made a terrible mistake. We did wrong. Let's do right. Let's transport the ark of God correctly. The priests and the Levites consecrated themselves to bring up the ark of the Lord, the God of Israel, and the Levites carried the ark of God on their shoulders with the poles as Moses had commanded according to the word of the Lord. That is an instructive addition to 2 Samuel 6, isn't it? So as I turn back to 2 Samuel 6, verse 13 gives us a little bit more of that when it says, those who bore the ark of the Lord, 2 Samuel 6:13, those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps. They sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal. And David danced before the Lord with all of his might. David was wearing a linen ephod. That's important because it tells us that David was dressed like the priests, like the Levites wore. Just a simple linen ephod. Not all the robes of royalty. You know, we get vision sometimes on TV. You see on TV various videos and various film footage of the royal family. And I mean, they've got every kind of medal and sash and, oh yeah. No, just a linen ephod. David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the horn. So here is proper worship before God. And if you'll notice here, when you do that, what you do is you get to worship with joy. And I would emphasize to you in verse 5, David and all the house of Israel were celebrating. Not all worship is somber and a lament, weeping, quiet and careful. There's a place for that kind of worship too. But there is a place for the worship that celebrates God and that says God is amazing and wonderful and good to us. And we want to rejoice and be joyous. So here, 13, 14, and 15 is that kind of worship. And I would add to this that sometimes people think all this discussion of God's rules about worship, that those things are oppressive and they suck all the life out of worship. But I would argue from 2 Samuel 6 that the very opposite is true. When you know that God is holy, and when you know how awesome God is, and when you understand that the wages of sin is death, then worship in some ways is a fearful thing. It's so amazing to come into God's presence, but because we are humans, we get so consumed with ourselves, and we're so prone to exalting ourselves and in pride and foolishness, doing things our way and thinking, oh, this is so great. We came up with this better idea. We're doing it better than God ever told us to do it. We just know so much more. Look at us, God. Aren't we incredible? And of course, that kind of worship meets with condemnation. In 2 Samuel 6, that kind of worship is not accepted at all. It brings death. So the reality is, if you'd read 2 Samuel 6 and you're taking God seriously, and somebody says, hey, you want to go to church with me? The answer to that is, I don't think so. I could get killed. I don't want to go to church. I don't want to be in the presence of God. I might do it wrong and offend God. I might be in sin when I think I'm doing it right. I might uzzah. I don't want to do that. Well, the response to that then is, oh, it's okay. God's told us how to worship. God has given us His laws and His rules and His statutes so that we can know what to do, so that we don't end up in sin, so we don't end up angering God. Okay. Tell me about how to worship God so that I can do that right. And the New Testament shows us that and teaches us that. So instead of being afraid to come into the presence of God, we would always take God seriously with reverence. But we can come to worship the Lord with joy instead of fear. I'm not afraid today. Are you? No. Look forward to coming and worshiping God. When we do worship the right way, rather than that being empty of meaning or life or spirit, our spirits worshiping God. No, instead, we can joyfully serve the Lord together. Isn't that an amazing gift? I'm so glad God tells us how to worship, because out of 2 Samuel 6, I'd be a little nervous about worshiping if He didn't. And that brings us then to this last little puzzling episode, verse 16. As the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked out of the window. She saw King David. She saw him leaping and dancing before the Lord. She despised him in her heart. So they brought in the ark of the Lord, and they set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And when David had finished offering burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. I should add here quickly, David is not a priest. And so he can't offer. What that means is he caused to have it to happen. We'll read soon about Solomon building the temple, and I don't think Solomon ever wielded a hammer, but he did cause it to occur, and so David is directing those who can offer to do so. David finished offering burnt offerings, verse 18, blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts, distributed among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, men and women, a cake of bread, a portion of meat, cake of raisins to each one. Then all the people departed, each unto his house. And David returned to bless his household. Just been an amazing day. Just wonderful, wonderful day. Everybody's sent home with little Debbie cakes, and it's just great. Okay, the little Debbie, that's in the Hebrew. You probably didn't see that. David returned then, verse 20, to bless his household. But Michal, notice again, she's designated as the daughter of Saul. She's not designated as the wife of David. She is the wife of David, and he loved her very much. But here again, she's called the daughter of Saul. And she came out to meet David, and she said, how the king of Israel honored himself today. There's just deep sarcasm here. uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servants and female servants as one of the vulgar fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. Unfortunately, verse 20 is as much misunderstood as maybe the things with Uzzah. People have decided that David danced naked. That's absolutely not true. The text specifically says, verse 15, David was wearing a linen ephod. It is unthinkable that David would dance naked. That is impossible in Israel. The Israelites are so careful about the body and about modesty. And all of that kind of thing is so much associated with Baal and idol worship. There is no chance that David would do that kind of thing. And again, David was wearing, verse 14, a linen ephod. What she is doing is she is exaggerating to make her point in her deep sarcasm. And the idea seems to be, you took your royal robes off. She's dressed like a commoner, don't you? What were you doing out there, David? Wearing just a linen ephod? Where was all the marks of royalty? And as we're reading that, and as we're hearing twice that she's called the daughter of Saul, what was Saul's problem? Saul's problem was that he saw himself as the king. He did not see himself as a steward of God's kingdom. He was the man. Look at me. He wore the royal robes. And Saul's daughter, Michal, seems now to be imitating and acting like Saul. Her idea seems to be that the king should avoid mixing with the people and be aloof and inaccessible, one scholar noted. Another wrote, there is no evidence that David was guilty of any of the things that the wife accused him of doing. He was properly attired and certainly did not expose himself to the people. His dance was before the Lord. But David recognizes in Michal the pride and spiritual blindness like her dad, whose only desire was to gain and keep popularity with the people. And so David says, verse 21, it was before the Lord who chose me above your father and above all his house to appoint me as a prince, not a king, that's a special word, ruler, to appoint me as a prince over the Israel, the people of the Lord, and I will celebrate before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this. I will be abased in your eyes. But the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I shall be held in high honor. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child to the day of her death. Is that because God struck her? Or is that because David said, I don't have anything else to do with you? I don't know. But I know this. David's humility here is a model for us. Did anyone notice that in 2 Samuel 5, when David took Jerusalem from the Jebusites, there was no public ceremony, no coronation chair, no big crown being placed upon the king's head. There was no big ceremony about David. The big ceremony in 2 Samuel 6 is about God. David says, I am not God. I need God. And I want to exalt and honor God. In a chapter that begins badly, ends in a wonderful way with a king who honors the Lord. So while there is much in this world that I do not understand, I must tell you that a careful look at 2 Samuel 6 helps me too understand exactly what's going on here. There was a reckless disregard and disrespect for God. And what might look good to men and women actually wasn't so good. There was sin, and that always equals death. But the chapter ends with repentance and turning to the Lord and doing God's things in God's ways, which leads to the blessings of God upon David, who humbles himself before the Lord. Let's pray about that. O Lord our God, we humble ourselves before you. You are God and we are not. And we pray today that our worship honors you because we do what you have instructed and taught us and told us to do through your holy word. We pray, Father, that our hearts are right and that our actions are right. We pray that you will bless and that you will accept our humble worship, because we need you. And we pray, Father, that you will bless our Bible classes now and our second worship service, and that especially you will bless our shepherds as they lead us to you. It's in Christ that we pray, and amen. That concludes our first worship service. If you're visiting with us this morning, we are really, really glad that you are here, and hope that you are edified by the Word of God. We'll continue that process now in our Bible class hour. Our Bible classes begin at 10 minutes to the hour and go to the bottom of the hour till 10:30. And I'm going to go ahead and send Bible class teachers, if you will head that way. You will be ahead of your students, who will be close behind you in just a moment. Our Bible classes are all on that side of the building, except for our adult Bible class. Our adult Bible class in Genesis chapter 50 will be in here. So adults, if you'll just stick around, we'll get to Genesis 50 in here in just a moment. But students, if you'll make your way to Bible class now, head that direction. Adults, we've got a little bit of a break here. If you'll stand at ease, get you a drink of water, stand up, stretch a little bit, shake some hands. We'll be back in here in 7 minutes, and we'll think about Genesis, the 50th chapter. Good morning, good morning. Open your Bible with me, please, to the 50th chapter of the book of Genesis, where we get an amazing and wonderful discussion of the end of Jacob's life and the end of Joseph's life. And this may look like just kind of some funeral stuff, but I want to assure you it is a whole lot more than that. And we had some of that conversation last week, and it's always a little bit hard to kind of, you know, hit play and resume. We're just going to pick that up. But let's read a little bit of text, and we'll talk a little bit about some of this, and we'll see if we can't get back, get our mindset going again, because forgiveness is hard. Forgiveness is hard. C.S. Lewis, who's one of my favorite writers, he says, everybody's for forgiveness until they have to forgive someone. And, you know, that's exactly right. If you come to me and you're telling me about somebody wronged you and you're mad about it, you're all bent out of shape and they want you to forgive, and you're like, well, I'm going to tell you, Jesus has forgiven you. You've been forgiven so much. 70 times 7, you need to be forgiven. What are you thinking? You better start your, you just need to be doing some forgiving. And then when someone comes to me and says, I need you to forgive me. Oh, I can't believe you did that. I'm so wronged. I don't know if I'm ever going to be able. Forgiveness is hard. Forgiveness is hard. And if there is any text in Scripture that gives us a roadmap to do it, or that just helps us do it, Genesis 50 may be that place. When someone comes to you and says, I need your forgiveness, and you're thinking, I just don't know, then you just go read Genesis 50, and in about a minute, you're going to say, I forgive. Because the spirit of Joseph and what Joseph does here will help us. So there's where we are in Genesis chapter 50. Let's see if we can pray together, and then we'll talk about forgiveness. Lord, we come before you now as our Bible classes begin, and we ask a blessing on every student and every teacher. We ask, Father, that our hearts would be open to your word. Help us, Father, to put aside the natural way of doing things, the things that we are inclined to do, the things that we want to do to please ourselves, and help us learn how to honor and glorify you instead. Help us to see in the life of Joseph the attributes of character that we need to imitate so that we can be faithful servants before you. Particularly, Father, I pray that when we are wronged, we are ready to forgive. In Christ we pray, and amen. So as you are looking at Genesis chapter 50, here's the breakdown of our chapter this morning. Joseph grieves for the loss of Jacob, his father, in the first 14 verses. And then this is where we are. In verse 15, Joseph needs to be Joseph again. Let's read this. And there were so many hands still up when the bell rang last week. Let's get ready to think about forgiveness. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, it may be that Joseph will hate us, pay us back for all the evil that we did to him. So they sent a message to Joseph saying, your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil unto you. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. And Joseph said to them, do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. So as we're thinking here about forgiveness, let me see here, pull my tablet up for me, please, gentlemen. Let's think a little bit in terms of what it is to forgive, and particularly in terms of what it is for Joseph to forgive. Oh, look at there. All kinds of good things are happening. And I want us to think a little bit here in terms of not just the brothers. So we kind of talked about them a lot last week. But let's see if maybe we could divide some of this out. And let's start talking about Joseph. in how Joseph is able to be Joseph. What kind of things are we seeing? Joseph starts talking in verse 19. We ought to talk about the brothers, okay? So the brothers are in the text here from 15 to 18, but it's Joseph that is in the text starting in verse 19 and the verses that are to follow. Let's think about, how do you be a Joseph? How do you act like a Joseph and all the things that go with that? And I'll start that conversation by noting in verse 19, do not fear. Do not fear. So what Joseph reminds us here is that forgiveness is a power issue. It's about who's got the power. When you do wrong, you have forfeited the place of power, and somebody now can hold that over you. In fact, that's exactly what we say. He's holding that over me. And that's a reference to the act of the executioner or the guillotine blader. You know, power is being held over you. And so the first thing that Joseph does is he gives up power. I don't want that. I wouldn't do that. I'm not going to do that. I'm not into that. It's not about me being one up over you. Now I have a chip to play. This time of the year, if you haven't watched White Christmas, you absolutely must watch White Christmas. It's an amazing and wonderful. Last week we had Home Alone. This week we have White Christmas. In White Christmas, if you're familiar with this movie, Bing Crosby gets saved by Danny Kaye, and Danny Kaye hurts his arm. And any time Danny Kaye wants something out of Bing Crosby, touches his, that's all he just touches. He just uses that as a chip to get what he wants. It's hilarious. Until somebody touches their arm at you. Joseph says, not going to do that. Not going to do that. No, not doing that. So if you're going to forgive somebody, you'll need to get rid of any kind of, boy, I got one now. You know, when I need, I'm going to be able to. Mm-mm. You let go of that. You let go of that. And in many ways, that's the essence of forgiveness, isn't it? God has one on us. Whew. One? Oh, my. God has so many on us. What does God do when he forgives? He turns all that loose. Turns all that loose. Don't worry about it on Day of Judgment. God's going, oh, looky here. I got this and that. Mm-mm. Turns loose. God turns loose of the power. Think about that. So Joseph turns loose of the power. So there I started you. What else do you see in Joseph's life here? Miss Lisa, what do you think? Okay, so I love that a lot. Forgiveness is God's business, which I'll abbreviate with a Z. Forgiveness is God's business. That's God's job. And so maybe particularly here, I would say this: revenge and squaring things, God takes care of that. God's the one who's in charge. Romans 12, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. One of the reasons that I can be so comfortable giving up the power is because God will take care of it. God will take care of it. And I should say this, if you're thinking, oh yeah, on Judgment Day. No, lots of times God takes care of it right now. Lots of times God takes care of it right now. You reap what you sow. And God's the one that makes sure the harvest comes up. And people who do bad things, lots of times bad things happen to them. That happens. But even if nothing bad happens, and they get off scot-free, they don't get off scot-free. Stand up on the Day of Judgment, and if they haven't made things right with God, God will take care of it. God will take care of it. I don't need to worry about that. I've got so many things on my plate. I'll just push that off my plate. God, you got this. Forgiveness is God's business. The righting of personal wrongs, God will take care of that. Joseph understands that. Billy? Wow, that is really good. That is really good. If you're streaming at home, we forgive you. No. If you're streaming at home, what Billy said was, Joseph has every reason to be angry at Egypt and angry at a lot of people. And he never goes after, hey, you forgot about me. I'd interpreted your dream 2 years, dude, 2 years before you thought about me. And that was only to help yourself. Pharaoh, what kind of lousy social justice system are you running around here? I'm an innocent guy. I got thrown in jail. I want to talk to you about how you're running this country. You don't ever get any of that. You don't ever get any of that. So if we want to be forgiving, if we want to be like Joseph, prepare for profound thought, you have to be like Joseph. Not just in the moment of trouble and trial and distress. You have to be like Joseph all the time. I'm not surprised. Nobody read Genesis 50 and was like, whoa, did not see that coming. Man, I thought Joseph was going to be like, okay, for all of these guys, line them up. Let's get their heads off. In fact, if we read in Genesis 50 that Joseph said, forgive you? Are you kidding me? I'm staking you out to an anthill, pouring honey on you, buddy. All of you guys is in so much trouble. That would cause us to go, wait, what? Joseph. So there is a consistency here in his character that is just truly amazing. Billy, that's a great point. I'm going to preach that, and you will get no credit for that. Everybody else will know. John West, help me here, please, sir. So there's the ultimate motivation. John, that's so helpful. There's the ultimate motivation to forgive, that we have been forgiven. The reason we can forgive the unthinkable in others is because God has forgiven the unthinkable in us. And so the Ephesians 4 passage helps us, but I really love, that's why I wrote it down, what you said about praying. I can't pray that you'll repent, and by the way, that's contingent, that's where that goes, okay? Repentance and then forgiveness. And we've talked about that before with Joseph's brothers. But I can't pray that you'll come to repentance and God will forgive you if I have an unforgiving heart. If I want God to forgive you, how about me? Then I need to be like God. I need to be ready to forgive. I need to be working for forgiveness. That's what God, for repentance, so there can be forgiveness. That's what God is certainly doing. What I see over here, somebody was, Miss Jenny? So here's the stress that's really good. Here's the stress that God can use evil for good. And instead of talking about the bad things, I was away from my family for 20 years. I was rotting in a prison. This terrible woman, she abused me. It was awful. And instead of talking about all that, he just talks about the good. He just puts the accent on the positive. God used this in a really, really good way. And it's all good. It's all good. We're in the hands of God. I've put this in the hands of God. It's God's business to do the forgiving, fellas. Y'all are talking to the wrong people. God used that in a good way. I'm out. You don't need to worry about this at all. Rusty, did I see a hand? That's really powerful. So we need to look for God's purposes in that. God wants everybody to be saved. And if I'm not willing to forgive someone when they're asking for forgiveness and they've repented and so forth, then somebody here is not going to be saved. And it just might be me if I'm the one who's not willing to extend forgiveness. But God's purpose is that everyone would humble themselves. Oh, Mark, you need to be careful. In about a minute, you're going to slide into the 10:40 sermon. God's purpose is here. Then you could go home. We're out. God's purpose is here is for us to repent. That's what God's seeking for. By the way, I'll just give you this for free. That's why unilateral forgiveness is bogus. This thing about, I just forgave him in my heart, and you know there was no repentance, no remorse, none of that. But I've already forgiven them. And that's become a driving theme in our society. No, what we want to say is, I'm ready to forgive. But I've already forgiven, like it's a done deal. That would stop me working for their repentance. No, I haven't forgiven yet. I can't forgive yet because they haven't repented. So I'm still praying. I'm still praying for them. And I'm still doing the things that will meet the purposes of God, that will help them to repent so that I can forgive. Because like God, I long to forgive. We're not just going to, I'm past that now. No. I'll never be past that in the sense of being able to extend forgiveness until an individual repents. And if you have further questions about that, I've talked about that a lot. I really don't want to redig that well. But Luke 17:3-4 is where Jesus says, when they repent, then you forgive. Alex? It really is another conversation about the same issue. And so maybe I appreciate that very much. It gives us an opportunity. Let's just think a little bit here about, man, you can't do that with a big whiteboard, okay? So that's pretty cool. Let's just think a little bit more about these brothers, okay? Because that's where Alex is talking about here. And he makes the observation here that they have not forgiven themselves. And I think that is true. I think that is true. I'm always careful with the forgiving yourself thing because that's not language the Bible uses, okay? And that doesn't mean that it's not a true concept. The expression youth lectures doesn't appear in the Bible. It doesn't mean it's not a biblical concept. But I would want to be careful and define what I mean by that if we're going to use that kind of term. We need to be careful that we don't make forgiveness about me. You know, I need to feel better about myself. So I need to accept myself, and we just need to be careful about some of those kind of things. But I guess what I would say, what Alex is saying here is that it doesn't seem like they've ever sat down with Joseph and really got this all worked out. I think they show evidence in their life of repentance and contrition and sorrow, but maybe at some point in time, they needed to sit down with Joseph and say, we did you wrong. This was really wrong, and they needed maybe to ask for formal forgiveness. There is no account in Scripture where that kind of thing happened. In Matthew 5, Jesus talks about if you've wronged your brother, you go and see your brother. And so I guess where I'm going with all of that is they just haven't dealt with this. They haven't dealt with this, and so it's just still hanging over their heads. Don't be a Joseph brother. If you and somebody are sideways, go deal with it. Get it done. Someone says, well, I don't think they're going to forgive me. Okay, go find out. Then maybe you could help them. Maybe you could talk about Genesis 50. I need you to be Joseph to me. Maybe you can weep together. Maybe you will find out that they long to forgive you and that they are seeking, and we're just praying and hoping that reconciliation could begin with some kind of formal forgiveness. Ignoring sin doesn't deal with sin. And the other thing that this text proves, Alex, I'm just putting words in your mouth, is time doesn't equal forgiveness. Oh, a lot of time went by, so we don't have to talk about it. Mm-mm. Still need to talk about it. Still need to get it done. Billy? So Billy's just in fuego today. What Billy said was what I wanted to say, make this really profound point. Thank you, Billy, for stealing my profound point. Forgiveness is a trust issue. And sometimes when people say, I haven't forgiven them myself, you know what they really mean? I have not believed God's forgiveness of me. I haven't accepted God's forgiveness. I couldn't forgive somebody like that. Isn't that what the brothers are saying? If you had done this to me, Joseph, buddy, we'd be getting a hold of you. And so they wouldn't do that. They couldn't do that. And they can't extend that forgiveness then. They can't believe somebody could do that kind of thing. They don't trust Joseph. And if you are struggling with God's forgiveness, you need to ask yourself, do I trust the Lord? Forgiveness is a trust issue. One scholar wrote, we who read this account centuries later want to say, men, what is your problem? Didn't Joseph forgive you and kiss you and weep over you and give you every evidence of his love? Didn't he explain that God had overruled for good all the evil you had done? Didn't Joseph make every provision to bring you to Egypt? Why are you alarmed? The answer is simple. They didn't believe their brother. The gracious way he spoke to them and the loving way he treated them had made no impact on their hearts. We need to believe God. And we need to believe a brother or sister when they say that you are forgiven. Max, what do you think about that? So part of that formal thing right here is this confession where you say, this is what I did, there's no excuse for it, and I know it was wrong. That is what's driving this. John Chaney, way back in the back. Joseph trusts God the whole way, and again, we're talking about now about forgiveness flowing out of a certain way of living your life, and Joseph just trusts God all the time. With Potiphar's wife, he is all about God in a situation where a lot of people would have conveniently forgotten the Lord. And then when Pharaoh says, I hear you do that dream thing, Joseph says, actually, buddy, you're wrong. No, I don't do dreams. Can't. Mm-mm. But God does. So, I mean, that's just the ideal opportunity to say, it's me. And Joseph says, it's not me. He just trusts God continually and constantly, and that enables him to forgive. His brothers do not have that kind of trust in Joseph or in God, and it just shows up here. If somebody's being hard-hearted to you, pretty good chance that there's a faith trust issue going on here. Steve? Oh, that's so good. That's so good. And what Steve said, if you're streaming at home, is that where we struggle is not the forgiving. God says, I forgive and remember no more. And we struggle with the remember no more. I can't blank my memory. We remember. We do remember. But the psalmist says that God forgives our iniquities as if he throws them in the deepest part of the sea, and then what Steve said is someone said, and then God posts the no fishing sign. And that's important. We don't want to keep bringing those sins up to God, and we don't want to keep bringing those sins up to somebody who has said we have forgiven. If we deal with our sin and in contrition, and we break our hearts, and we don't make excuses, and we say, I need you to forgive, I will tell you this, it is going to be a really rare occasion that somebody says, I can't forgive you. I'm not going to forgive you. That when you are being everything that Scripture wants us to be, and you are seeking that kind of reconciliation to begin in times of forgiveness, then most people are going to break down too. Most people are going to break down too and be ready to forgive. Most people are going to be the Joseph if we'll just do what's right. Jonathan? Jonathan, I like that a lot. There's some reaffirmation that's going on here. And so if somebody has wronged you and you forgive, they may come back around like Joseph's brothers and just feel a little queasy about it. And you may need to speak kindly and comfort them to continue to affirm that relationship and to continue to affirm, oh, hey. No, don't be bringing that up. You dealt with that. You made confession. I've forgiven you. No. We're all good. Notice what he says twice. Don't fear. People who have sinned, broken relationship, they're just afraid. They're afraid of you. And so we need to do some reassuring and reaffirming kinds of things. I like that. Last call. Somebody else, what else are we going to say about that? Brother Kersey? Oh, that's so good. To be like God, to be ready to forgive. God has forgiven so much. And particularly, I love Jim's emphasis, to go and talk with a person and get it worked out. I would say this, I'll add this to what Jim said. I think sometimes we're afraid to go talk to somebody because we're holding this in our heart as this really big deal. And if we go and talk with them, it will dissolve into little more than a misunderstanding. And then, I got my feelings all, my feathers all ruffled and my feelings all wadded up and so forth and so on. And was thinking all kinds of bad things about you and so forth and so on. And then when we go, it turned, and I thought, oh, I have this thing and we got to get this worked out. And they're like, And they have a perfectly plausible explanation for what happened. And I realize I've been harboring hard heart and heart, bad thoughts and evil suspicions and so forth. I'm just being a jerk about this, and there really was nothing to it. So maybe that's why we don't go, because we want to hold that power. We want to hold those bad thoughts. We want to believe bad. No, get it worked out. It may be that there was sin here, and they have to repent, and there's contrition and sorrow and tears and all the things that go with that, and then we can worship God together and we've done what pleases the Lord. We've brought a soul back, and we've helped that person. Or it may be the whole thing just falls apart, and we realize, oh my, should have come talk to you a whole long time ago about this. I've been thinking all these bad things all this time. There's no need for any of that. That this was just a misunderstanding. It wasn't a matter of sin. And whatever it is, get it done. Remember in Matthew 5, Jesus says, you're on your way to church. You know your brother has something against you. Don't go to church. Turn around. Go get it fixed with your brother. Matthew 18, brother's out of line. Verse 15, go see him. Get that thing fixed. Work that out. If we had more Josephs and more of the spirit of Joseph, there would be less of those kinds of problems. Sometimes, you want to know where church division comes from? Sometimes church division comes because two brothers have some kind of problem and they won't get it worked out. And then all the friends of this brother, they're mad at that brother too. So then he gets his team and all of them. Well, now we're mad at all of those folks over there. Now you have what? Yeah, you have two parties in the church. You got strife, you got bickering, and now things are starting. And so this team's mad at this team, this bunch is mad at that bunch. And so one of these guys gets up and leads saying, oh, I can't believe I did it. Everything becomes an issue because we started off mad. And it all started from over nothing. It all just started over nothing. We got to do better than that. We've got to do better than that. So here we are in Genesis. Let's read a little bit further. Whew. Trying to decide if I can get this last little section in. Really good conversation. Really appreciate your help with that today. Let's think about Joseph looking forward to the promised land. In Genesis 50 and verse 22, Joseph remained then in Egypt, he and his father's house, and Joseph lived 110 years. He was 17 when he was taken to Egypt, Exodus 37:2. So he lived there 93 years. 51 of them would have been with his family there in Egypt with him. Those who do the math have figured that out for me. You know I didn't do that. Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation, verse 23. Children also of Makir, the son of Manasseh, were counted as Joseph's own. So, Ephraim's children here are spotlighted because Jacob had adopted Ephraim. There's not more conversation about Manasseh. So Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will visit you, bring you up out of this land, to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Look how the promises of God just keep stitching themselves into the account of these stories. That's really what the stories are about. What is God doing? What has God promised? How is that going to come to pass? So Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely visit you and shall surely carry up my bones from here. And Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. I'll give you a note here. So Joseph actually was not taken back to Canaan. And so the book of Genesis closes with us wondering, what happened? How come they didn't do that? How come they didn't take him up? What's the deal with that? And the term for coffin, he was put in a coffin, is the same term for ark, as in Ark of the Covenant. So when the children of Israel entered the land of Canaan, they entered with two arks. One carrying the Ten Commandments and Aaron's rod that budded and a pot of gold containing manna, and one ark containing the bones of Joseph. And as you would know this, as that was discussed among the rabbis, conversation about all of that, this is what they came to say. All the time in the desert, Israel carried two shrines with them. One was an ark containing the bones of the dead man Joseph, and the other the ark containing the covenant of the living God. And the Israelites saw the two arks, and they wondered and would ask, how doth the ark of the dead come next to the ark of the ever-living? And the answer is, the dead man enshrined in one ark fulfilled the commandments enshrined in the other. That's pretty good. So one was a coffin. We don't think of the Ark of the Covenant as being a coffin, but it's the same term. And I think very importantly, the book of Genesis here ends on a note of expectation, indeed a note of certainty, that the promises of God are going to be fulfilled. And they have not. We've not lost sight of those. So let me give you applications here out of chapter 50 very, very quickly. From the first part, we talked about this extensively, Jacob and his funeral here. And then secondly then, forgiveness is a trust issue. You have to trust the Lord. And then thirdly, trials and tribulations are no excuse not to trust in God. Joseph has been through so much, and we might think that he has every reason to give up on God and to give up on his faith, and he just keeps persevering through all of that with trust in God. Whatever's going on in your life, and there are people sitting in this auditorium this morning who had a tough week and bad things happened, and I'm sorry about that, but whatever's happened, it's no excuse to quit on the Lord. You just keep serving God, and that's why you're here this morning. So there we go. Book of Genesis is a pretty amazing book. Just absolutely an amazing, amazing book. And I think you learn something every time you study the Bible, but I don't think I had noticed before how much room Joseph gets. Joseph gets more text than Abraham does. Wow. Says something about how important he is in the Bible, isn't it? Very, very significant. All right, parents, Bible class is over. Go grab yourself a kid. We have a 10-minute break until we worship. This is stand-up time. Yeah, you got to get the blood pumping. Move around a little bit. We'll talk about the essentials this morning in worship.
Good morning. Time to begin the second part of our worship service this morning. I want to say welcome to those of you that are visiting. And then those of you who are joining us online, we're going to start our worship this morning singing Jesus, Hold My Hand.
Do me so as I travel through this pilgrim land. There is a friend who walks with me. Leads me safely through the streets, and it is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my burden, Lord, each day to help me do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour. Through this and this pilgrim land, my saving God, hear my plea, my feeble plea. Lord, dear Lord, look down on me when I kneel in prayer. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I wander through the valley, there toward the setting of the sun, lead me safely to a land of rest and by a crown of life at one. I have looked my faith in thee, dear Lord, that I may reach the golden strand. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour. Through this land, this pilgrim land, thy saving power, hear my plea, my feeble plea. Lord, hear, Lord, look down on me when I kneel in prayer. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
This time will be led in prayer by Brother Todd Hudgens.
Would you bow with me, please? Dear God, our holy heavenly Father, we are indeed so grateful to be gathered today with our brothers and sisters in Christ to come and to worship you. We'd like to begin, dear Lord, knowing and recognizing that we're sinners and fall short of your glory and ask for forgiveness. Help us, dear Lord, to always find the error in our life and repent of it and turn back to you. We're indeed thankful, dear Lord, this morning for the elders we have in this congregation and their willingness to serve you and your church, to shepherd our flock, to encourage and strengthen each and every one of us. We thank you for the deacons and the work that they give, the time they spend away from their families doing work on behalf of your church. We ask that you will bless them and their families in these endeavors. Dear God, we pray for Mark Roberts as he brings his lesson this morning, that he'll have a ready recollection of all the things that he's studied, that we'll have open hearts, open minds, and ears, that we'll hear this word, that we'll study it, show it approved, and apply it to our lives. We pray, dear Lord, for those who are ailing at this time, whether it be physical or spiritual sickness, that if it's your will, dear Lord, you will restore their health to them, that they'll be able to be back out to encourage us as we encourage them. Dear Lord, we pray that as we go through this service, everything we do will be in accordance with thy will, that we will worship thee from our hearts, that it will be true and acceptable unto you. Is our prayer in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
The scripture reading for today is from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 13 through 18. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 13 through 18. This year, the Westside Church is spending the year with the Apostle Paul by reading his life's journey and his writings. 2 Timothy is the last letter Paul would ever write. It is full of pointed admonitions to Timothy, as Paul knows that his time on earth is running out. Please open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 13 through 18, and please let's be standing for the reading of God's Word. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. You are aware that all who are in Asia turned away from me, among whom I Phygellus and Hermogenes. May the Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus, for he has often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. But when he arrived in Rome, he searched for me earnestly and found me. May the Lord grant him to find mercy from the Lord on that day. And you well know all the service he rendered at Ephesus. Okay, remain standing. Oh, remain seated, please. Don't want to make that mistake. Thank you, brother.
Till prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, we'll sing, "My Eyes Have Seen Your Glory."
Oh,
to focus our minds. And this is something I actually read this last Sunday as a scripture verse, and it stuck with me, so I thought we read it this week in our scripture readings. But in Titus 1:2, in Paul's greeting, he says this: "In hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began." What a powerful statement that is, that God before time promised eternal life and that he never lies. There are a lot of attributes about God in that statement, but the one I want to focus on is that he never lies. And it's because of that we can trust in God and the many promises that he's made. And so I have some examples. Mark 11:24. "Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours." In a moment, when we're partaking, we're going to go to God in prayer, and we can trust that he hears us. Isaiah 40:31. "But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint." Anybody feeling tired or weary? Our minds are going to be on Jesus and the sacrifice that he made for us. He overcame death and sin, and we can trust that we can too, and we can take strength in that. Lastly, 1 John 1:9. "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Is there a more powerful or important promise that we have? That we can trust that if we repent, we can become clean again? That's just a couple of the promises, but the point is that we can trust in the Lord because he never lies. I hope that helps you as we partake today.
Pray with me, please. Our Holy Father in heaven, we bow before you at this time to thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity this morning to worship you. We're just thankful at this time for the bread, and we just pray that we can use the symbolism of this emblem to remind us of the body that came to this earth and that was offered as a sacrifice for our sins. And we're just thankful for Jesus and for the sacrifice that he did make for us. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you. We believe in the power of your promises, and we believe in the power of the blood. Help us, Lord, as we partake today to reflect upon the sacrifice that was given for us. Help us not to see. Help us not to see what we often look at as Jesus on the cross with very little blood, but help us to see what really occurred, so that we can truly understand the rawness of it all. That we can truly understand the sacrifice that was given for us. And as we reflect upon that, to understand what was given to us, the free gift that costs so much. Help us to reflect upon this as we partake. All this we pray in Jesus, our Savior's name, amen.
That concludes the Lord's Supper. This time we'll be singing The Great Redeemer. If you'll stand as we sing this song, Psalm Before the Lesson.
Do me so, how I love the great Redeemer, who is there.
Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. My Bible's open to Luke chapter 8, and we're going to start there. You need to activate your Bible, whether that's a digital Bible, whether that's a paper Bible. We are in the Word of God in this portion of our worship. Join me in Luke chapter 8 and verse 15. What an amazing way for us to begin our week. I suppose the Lord could have ordained that our worship services are on Thursday afternoon, but the Lord has asked us to begin our week on the first day of the week, remembering Him and worshiping Him and serving Him. And part of that is certainly the resurrection of Jesus on the first day of the week, but part of that is it just helps us to start the week right. Fixed on Jesus, centered on what matters most, seeing our brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm delighted that you are here. I'm delighted that we can be together, and I'm delighted that we can serve the Lord in this capacity together. Lots of that is covered in Luke 8. I'm reading in verse 15, please. In Luke 8 and verse 15, as Jesus explains the parable of the sower, Jesus says at the end of that parable that fourth soil, the good soil, Luke 8, 15, the good soil, those are the ones who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience. Honest and good heart. Now, I should say that in some ways the parable of the sower is a hard parable for me. If Jesus had wanted to tell the parable of the good cup of coffee, I'm all about it. If Jesus wants to tell the parable of the baseball team that always struggled because it did not have good pitching and finally they signed an ace and there was much rejoicing, I would certainly understand about that parable. But this is a parable about farming, about gardening. I'm not all about that. I don't like yard work. I don't want a garden. I don't want to do any of those kinds of things, because in this parable, Jesus talks about the hard work that goes in bringing forth a harvest. And there is hard work. There is lots of hard work. Those of you who do the garden kind of thing, or those of you who have a farm or who grew up on a farm, you know that while Jesus doesn't cover everything in Luke 8 in the parable of the sower about that, there is so much that goes into receiving a great crop. There is so much hard work necessary to have good soil. You don't just show up in the spring and start throwing seeds around, and then kabang, you end up with this amazing crop. No, there needs to be plowing, and there has to be weeding and fertilizing and all kinds of other stuff to prepare the soil to receive the seed. Good soil doesn't just happen. It is made ready. And that is why I'm preaching this series on the essentials, because I want to talk with you about what's necessary to prepare the heart so that it'll be a good and honest heart and it will receive the seed, the word of God. Last week we talked about the day of Pentecost and how on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, 3,000 people obeyed the gospel, but not everybody obeyed the gospel that day. A whole lot of people saw the miracles. A whole lot of people heard the preaching, but not everybody responded to that. Some had hearts that were ready to receive the gospel. Others did not. And even more than just becoming a Christian, there are things necessary to keep in our heart so that we can remain faithful to the Lord, so that we will continue in Jesus Christ. And again, while some grow deeper and deeper in the Christian life, others fade away. There just are essential characteristics of heart that are necessary if we are going to obey the gospel and if we are going to maintain our loyalty to Jesus Christ. And that's what we're going after in this series. That's what I want to talk with you about. Last week, we did visit that sermon in Acts chapter 2, and we talked about humility. We talked about the understanding, I'm not God. I need God. That's the essence of humility that starts everything and that keeps everything running. But as I look again at Luke 8 and verse 15, the idea of holding fast in an honest and good heart, I want to think more about what happens there. And so I'm going to the pinnacle of that Acts 2 sermon. You know where I'm going. This is Acts 2 and verse 38. In Acts 2 and in verse 38, listen to Peter. In Acts 2 and 38, Peter says there to people who are humbling themselves, I'm not God. I need God. Acts 2:38, Peter said unto them, repent. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What is that about? That first thing he says. How do I do that? How do I repent? What do I need to build into my life so when I need my repenter, it will work? And I can run my repenter and be effective with it as Peter is describing in Acts 2:38. If I am not God and I need God, that should lead me to repentance. What then are the essentials of repentance? And maybe right now you're just thinking, Mark, did you say run the repenter? What is a repenter, Mark? Every one of us needs one. Our repenter is the part of us that causes us to change. It is the part of our character that moves us to make changes. That is what repentance is all about. Let's stack some passages in the Old Testament. I'm starting in 2 Chronicles. In 2 Chronicles, let's read in chapter 7. In 2 Chronicles 7 and verse 14. This is part of the prayer of Solomon. And in 2 Chronicles 7, in 2 Chronicles 7 and verse 14, there Solomon says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. So here Solomon prays and God responds to him, and God says what? Verse 14, if people humble themselves, what will they do? They will change. They will turn from their wicked ways. Change is at the very heart of repentance. Repentance is to make a change. More Bible, more passages. In Isaiah 55, there the prophet says this. In Isaiah, the 55th chapter, in Isaiah 55 and verse 7, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Let's look at this from the New Testament side of things. In Matthew, in Matthew's gospel, in Matthew the third chapter. In Matthew the third chapter, this is the preaching of John the Baptist. In Matthew the third chapter and in verse 8, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. There's a change that's going to be made. You're going to be able to see it. It's going to happen. You're going to be able to bear fruit. In the 12th chapter of Matthew's gospel, in Matthew 12 and in verse 41, there Jesus says, in Matthew 12 and verse 41, the men of Nineveh, they will rise up at the judgment with this generation and they will condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here. What the men of Nineveh do? They changed. They made dramatic and huge changes. Now in Acts the third chapter, in Acts the third chapter, let's plug in Acts 3 and verse 19. In Acts 3 and verse 19, I love these simultaneous expressions being used by Peter here. In Acts 3 and verse 19, there Peter says, repent therefore and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out. Repentance is a turning. Repentance is a change. Finally, how about the last book of the Bible? In the book of Revelation, I'm going to highlight two passages there. In Revelation 2 and in verse 5, as part of the message to the church at Ephesus, in Revelation 2 and 5, here Jesus says, Revelation 2, 5, remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come unto you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. The whole idea there is summed up in this idea of making a change. In Revelation then, again in chapter 9, in Revelation chapter 9, in Revelation 9 and verse 20. In Revelation 9 and verse 20, the text here says, the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues, they did not repent of the works of their hands. They didn't give up worshiping demons or idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, which cannot see or hear or walk, nor did they repent of their murderers or of their sorceries or their sexual immoralities or their thefts. The summary, the Mark Roberts International East Texas version of Revelation 9, 20, 21 is the rest of mankind did not change. Repentance is about change. And that would mean for you and me this morning that repentance is not primarily about emotions. Repentance is not first and foremost a sudden downpour of our feelings. Emotion is involved, it is part of this, but feeling something is not the sum total of repentance. And that would also mean that repentance is not just about admitting that you've done wrong. We've come to the place in society where if you do something terrible, and it's in all the news and everybody's talking about it, that what you do is you hold a press conference and you say, I accept full responsibility for what I have done. Which then means you accept no responsibility for what you have done, because now if somebody asks you, you say, I've moved on. I've put that in my past. And I want to say to you this morning that an admission of wrong is part of repentance. It is part of that change process, but it is so much more than just saying some words, I'm so sorry. And that means, of course, that repentance also is not simply about doing better. People make changes all the time, and people will stop sinning for a lot of reasons. Because sin is unproductive, because sin is unhealthy, because sin can be self-defeating. However, while we are talking about making a change, simply making a change is not everything that repentance is all about. The idea of this change of repentance is we are changing because we wronged God. You see how that's flowing out of humility? I'm not God. I need God. I've wronged God. That must change. 2 Corinthians is the passage that helps us here. In 2 Corinthians 7, in 2 Corinthians 7 and in verse 8, Paul writes to the brethren in Corinth, and he writes to them his second letter. He writes them here to say, I had to send you a really tough first letter. And Titus told me about that you received that letter and it caused a lot of emotion and upset. And he says in 2 Corinthians 7 and verse 8, even if I made you grieve with my letter, I don't regret it. Though I did regret it, I see that the letter grieved you, though only for a while. So 1 Corinthians caused sorrow. Paul says, I'm sorry that you were sorry. But you know what? I'm not really sorry that you were sorry, because I rejoice, now verse 9, not because you were grieved, but because you were grieved into repenting. You felt a godly grief so that you suffered no loss through us. For godly grief produces a repentance that leads unto salvation without regret. Whereas worldly grief produces death. There is a sorrow that feeds upon itself and will devour you. But there is a different kind of sorrow, not worldly sorrow, godly sorrow that places a value on God, that makes it about God, not about me, about what I have done to God. Because I am not God, because I need God, then I must obey God. I need to submit to God's will. I need to honor God. I need to glorify God. I need to love God. I need to trust God. And when I don't do that, whatever is in the way of those things, I need to be sorry about that. And I need to change that. That's going to involve a change of mind, how I think about sin. And that is certainly going to involve a change of life and behavior. I'm going to stop doing what's wrong. I'm going to start doing what's right. There'll be a change in the direction of my life. But I can't emphasize enough to you this morning, there will be a change in my motivation and purpose. It's not about me. It's not about satisfying me and what I want to do with my life. Sin will satisfy you. Well, at least for a period of time. There's the passing pleasures of sin. No, I'm not going to make my life about me. And I'm not even going to make my life about how I feel about me so that I can feel better about me. No, this is all about God. I want to please and honor God. So when I find in my life that I have not done that, then I need to say, I will change. That is the essence of repentance. It is a change of mind that leads to a change of life. It means that I am going to serve the Lord in a better way because I'm going to stop serving myself. And it is fundamental to everything that we are doing to become a disciple and to remain as a disciple. And you can certainly, I should say this, you can certainly build a much more complicated definition of repentance that is more nuanced and that has more to it. But in a series on the essentials, I'm trying to strip things down to the very bare essence. And I think beyond anything else, repentance at its bare essence is saying, I will change. I will change. And there are a couple things that go into that. A couple things that means. First and foremost, somewhere in here, you got to put the word can. I can do that. I can change. Let's go back to our text in Luke 8. Let's go back to our text in Luke 8 because there's someone else in the parable of the sower besides just the sower. In Luke 8, read at the beginning of the parable, please, in Luke 8 and verse 4. In Luke 8 and in verse 4, Jesus says this. There was a great crowd gathering, Luke 8, 4. People from town after town came to him, and Jesus said in the parable, a sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. What's that about? Well, in verse 12, Jesus explains. The seed that's sown on the path, Luke 8, 12. Those are the ones who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their heart so they may not believe and be saved. So in this parable, God is sowing the good seed. The seed is the word of God. It is the gospel. It is powerful. The gospel is so powerful it can take men and women who are not right with God and make them right with God. Think about what a single seed can do. What a great metaphor for the gospel. The seed, the word of God, can bring you into right relationship with the Lord. But Jesus says, verse 12, somebody else is at work too. The devil. The devil is in this. And the devil hates repentance. The devil doesn't want anybody to be humble. What do you mean you're not God? Think about the original temptation. What do you mean you need God? You don't need God. And what about changing? Oh, no, no, no. And right there, particularly, the devil spreads lies. What does the devil say when someone says, I need to change. I can change. The devil says, no, you can't. Mm-mm. No, you'll never beat this sin. You were born this way, don't you know? I mean, come on, look at your life. Look how many times you have failed. There's no reason to even try. You can't do this. You are glued in place right where you are. I mean, maybe if angels sang and a light shone down from heaven, maybe if God did something miraculous in your life, you could change. But I don't see any light and I don't hear angels. So you, buddy, you are stuck. You can't change. Let me give you two key passages. In 1 Corinthians 6, in 1 Corinthians 6, we answer the lies of the devil with the truth of God's word. And in 1 Corinthians 6, Paul says to the brethren in Corinth, in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 9, do you not know, 1 Corinthians 6, 9, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters or adulterers, or men who practice homosexuality, or thieves, nor greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Now verse 11. And such were some of you. Such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Paul says to the Corinthians, you changed. You did it. If they did it, guess what? You can too. In fact, in Luke 15, Jesus tells the parable of the prodigal son. And what is at the center of that parable is this little section I read now for you in Luke 15, and in verse 17. After the young man had wasted all of his money in ridiculous rebellion and every kind of wicked sinning that he could possibly do, Luke 15, 17 says, when he came to himself. He said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread and I am perishing here with hunger? I will arise. I will go to my father. I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. Jesus telling a fairy tale there? Is that what that is? Jesus telling a big tall tale that can't possibly happen? Does the prodigal son include, and he was able to leap tall buildings in a single bound, then he unfurled his red cape and flew home? No, that is not what the text says at all. What the text says is that the Corinthians changed. What the text says is the prodigal son changed, and what the text is telling you and what the text is telling me, despite all that the devil says, is we can change. There is no sin that you cannot overcome by the grace and power of God, with the blessings of the Lord in your life, by the blood of the Lamb. If you repent, you can be forgiven. Don't believe the lie that you can't. What you need to know is you must. Repentance isn't just a good idea. And it's not something just for the elite level Christians. But you know, I'm not really feeling like SEAL Team 6. I'm not at that. So I'm just going to stay down here. I'll let the repenting stuff, I'll just let other folks do that kind of thing. No, it's not optional. In fact, it's at the very heart of the gospel itself. I'm turning again in the book of Luke now to chapter 13. In Luke, the 13th chapter, Luke is the gospel that emphasizes repentance so much. Jesus says twice here in Luke 13 that repentance is mandatory. In Luke 13, read with me there in verse 3. Jesus says there, I tell you, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. And then Jesus says at the end of this gospel, in Luke 24, Jesus says there at the end of this gospel, in Luke 24 and verse 46, what is the preaching of the gospel going to entail? What's that going to be all about? In Luke 24, 46, Jesus opens their minds, verse 45, to understand the scriptures, and he said to the apostles, so it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, so that repentance, Luke 24, 47, repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations beginning from Jerusalem. That is, by the way, what drives the Acts 2 story, isn't it? That's what Peter's doing on the day of Pentecost. He's fulfilling Luke 24. He's preaching repentance for the forgiveness of sins. What that means is when I see sin in my life, it must stop. It has to end. We cannot cherish sin. We can't hold on to sin. We can't defend sin. We can't ignore sin. We can't live in sin. We change. We change our mind. We change our lives. We change our motivations. We change our priorities. We change. And I say to you again, make sure you put this in the proper place. We need this attitude, this readiness to change, to accept God's will and make life correction. We need that in place to become a Christian. And we have to keep that in place so that we can activate repentance in our lives. Whenever we have strayed from God's will, we can come back and do what God wants us to do. If you want to be good soil, this is fundamental to serving God in everything we do. It is absolutely essential. Which maybe right now you're thinking, well, how am I going to do that? That is difficult. Change is hard. I don't like change. What can I do to cultivate the repenting spirit? In some ways, we don't talk about that a lot. We talk about what repentance is, and we talk about how essential it is, and bearing fruit. But maybe we don't talk nearly enough about just how to get your spirit ready to do that. And the result of that is some people's repenter is broken. Or maybe it's rusted over or hardened. They're not any good at doing this. They're good at making excuses. They're good at telling everybody else why they're so wrong. They're good at pushing away the Word of God, but they're not very good at repenting. They're not very good at making that change. What can I do to get my heart right to be good soil? Very quickly this morning, let me just share with you a couple of things from a man who was really good at it. Really, really good at it. He kept his repenter in good operating order. His name is David. And I want to call attention to four characteristics in David's life that show that he had installed deeply into his heart the ability to repent. And some of these things that we talk about here, they will look like the how to repent, but that's not all that they are. Even more, they are the way we learn to be ready to repent. So we want to put these in place and we want to practice them. We want to do them as much as we can all the time so that when we need to repent, we can. We're ready to make that change. That starts with this: a willingness to take ownership of our mistakes and to do it immediately. David is phenomenally good at this. In David's life, there are several places where he makes a mistake or even sins. And yet, he is so quick to turn back to God. So quick to change. You just see it again and again. There's a time when he's on the run from Saul, and he goes to the tabernacle and gets some provisions there, and that ends up with Saul showing up at the tabernacle, and Saul ends up having the priest there murdered. And when David gets word of that, David immediately says, "That's on me. I shouldn't have gone there. I'm responsible for that." And that's not the only time. At the end of Samuel, David numbers the people of Israel, which he should not have done because that just leads to pride. Look how big my kingdom is. Aren't I just amazing? And the text tells us that even before God said, you've done wrong, even before God punishes David for that, it says David's heart struck him. He knew. He knew. He takes ownership of that. In fact, this morning in 2 Samuel 6, I preached about the death of Uzzah when he touched the ark. And when the chronicler talks about that in 1 Chronicles 15, David tells the priest, you boys need to carry the ark. There's the mistake. That got Uzzah killed. And then he says, because we didn't seek the Lord's way, disaster befell us. He takes ownership of that. But maybe the most famous illustration of that is in 2 Samuel 12. In 2 Samuel, the 12th chapter, Nathan the prophet comes to confront David about his sin with Bathsheba. And as certainly as I'm saying David was quick to repent, someone is going to remark that maybe as much as a year has gone by where David is living in sin. And that is absolutely so. But what is also absolutely so is that as soon as Nathan calls him out, as soon as Nathan says, you're the man, David, in 2 Samuel chapter 12, as soon as Nathan approaches him and tells him what he has done, in verse 13, David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. That was hard. They were there in the palace, in the throne room, in front of everybody, all of his friends, important dignitaries, all these ambassadors, everybody who's there, right there, they're all watching him. That's embarrassing. Nathan, how about you take me aside privately? No. Nathan doesn't do that. And in front of everybody, David has to take responsibility for what he has done. And I need to practice, and you need to practice exactly that. Excuse making and denial, that blocks repentance. That says, I don't need to change. David says, I've done wrong. I'm going to have to make change. In fact, I was reading this week, and a fellow was tweeting out some stuff about being effective in business. And he said this, learn to enjoy being wrong. Value finding the truth over being right. Retrain your mind to embrace new information that forces a change in your viewpoint. Now, I'm not sure about enjoying being wrong, but you know what he means by that? Yes. That when I am wrong, I can learn something if I'm willing to embrace new information. Get in the habit of immediately saying, oh, I'm sorry, that was wrong. I'm responsible for that. Get in the habit of quickly taking ownership for your sins. And then we want to speak the truth about sin. In the Psalms, in Psalm 32, David writes about this terrible episode with Bathsheba. And he says in Psalm 32 and verse 1, blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven and whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against the Lord, against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Then he says this, Psalm 32, 5. I acknowledge my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. David uses three terms here. He says, I'm going to acknowledge my sin. Then he talks about refusing to cover his sin. Then he talks about confessing his transgression. Repentance, change, comes when there is deep-rooted certainty of sin. This is wrong. There's no excuse for it. I did it. I harmed God. I grieved God when I did this. When there is that kind of certainty in our heart, it can rise from our heart. And it can be spoken. It can be said. It can be confessed. And we want to do more than just do that for ourselves. We certainly want to speak the truth about sin in our lives. But we want to speak the truth about all sin. The more we talk about how sin is wrong and is not to be tolerated and can't be right, but the more we draw closer to God And the more we are adapting and adopting God's viewpoint of sin, the easier it will be for us to say, I got to change. That's sin. We talk about that all the time. Can't be doing that. But the more we make excuses, even for others, the more we tolerate and overlook iniquity, the more we are teaching ourselves, you know, what they did wasn't so bad, so what I did wasn't. We're fouling up our ability to repent. And what we want to do is put that focus on God's opinion of me, not on others. What does everybody else think about me? That's not important. What matters most is what God says about my life. And this is a significant idea because repenting isn't very popular today. You're not going to cut on the news or click on a news story and it's going to say, the congressman who's been involved in scandal held a news conference today to announce that he was repenting. You're not hearing that. That's not how you handle doing bad things. And that is not what PR people and media handlers and press agents are taught about how to extricate somebody out of a scandal. What you do is you stonewall. What you do is you refuse to answer direct questions because you always, always, always want to make yourself look as good as possible in the public eye. That is the opposite of repentance. In the Psalms again, in Psalm 51, the other psalm that David wrote about his sin with Bathsheba, he says this in Psalm 51:4. In Psalm 51:4, David says this, against you, and you only, God, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Don't get it twisted here. David is certainly aware that he sinned against Bathsheba, that he sinned against her husband, that he sinned against all of Israel. But David is so focused on how he mistreated God, that's where he is first and foremost. God, I know what you think of me because of what I have done. I must change. And in all of that, David most certainly is aware of the pain of sin. In the 17th verse of the same psalm, Psalm 51, David says in verse 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despair. Repentance is certainly far more than a feeling, but feeling is part of it. We can't harm God and walk away with that with just a shrug of our shoulders. Paul wrote about godly sorrow. And while sometimes we're not much on emotion because emotion can get out of place, and emotion is certainly not the lead engine dragging all of this. Emotion needs to follow behind right ideas and right understanding, but emotion needs to be there. Let me show you a passage in Ezra. In Ezra 9, Ezra is told that the people of God are in sin. And in Ezra 9, look at verse 3. In Ezra 9 and verse 3, as soon as I heard this, I tore my garment. I tore my cloak, and I pulled hair from my head and my beard, and I sat appalled. The truth of the matter is, sometimes what we need to do is rend our garments. And to sit appalled, deeply moved and profoundly sorrowful as we cry out to God, I want to change. I need to repent. And the reality is, we sang Wednesday night as our invitation song, Bring Christ Your Broken Life. The reality is, sometimes the reason we don't repent is because we're not sorry our life is broken. And maybe in some ways, we're not even convinced our life is broken. But when we have humility I'm not God. And I need God. I need God's word. I need God's direction. I need God's commands. I need God in my life. Then necessarily, what follows behind that, I got to make some changes so that I can honor God. I will repent. I will change. So as our text says in Luke 8 and verse 15, there is a kind of soil that is responsive to the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. It is, Luke 8:15, good soil. The kind of soil that hearing the Word holds it fast in an honest and good heart and bears fruit with patience. Even though I don't like gardening and yard work, I get it. I get it. I see the need for it, not just on a farm, not just on a garden. Who will become a Christian? Who will stay a Christian? The one who can repent. The one who has the heart and character, who is ready to say, I will change. That is essential. Would you pray with me, please? Oh, Lord our God, we are not God. We humble ourselves before you and acknowledge our great need for you. And because we need you, we see the gap in our lives between who we are and what you have made us to be, and how far short we fall of your glory. So we ask, Father, that you would bless our repentance. Bless us, Father, as we make the changes necessary so that we can serve you fully and wholeheartedly. And as always, Father, we would ask that you would bless our shepherds here as they lead us to know you and serve you through your Son. It is in his name we pray, and amen. This morning, it may be that you are here and you are ready to humble yourself by making a change. Be mindful that in Acts 2:38, that repentance, the change, is followed then by baptism for the forgiveness of sins. Part of the change is to say, I haven't done what God has said. I have not been obedient. And now I change, and I will do anything that God tells me to do. Would you repent this morning? Then you will be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. And we'd love to help you do that. If you are a Christian and you're not serving the Lord as you should, we would love to help you repent and turn back to the Lord to make those changes so that you can serve the Lord in a better way. We give you some time. We sing this song to help you examine your life and then say, I can change, I must change, I will change, I will repent. Can we help you? Make your way down front while we stand, while we sing.
seated.
Another important part of our worship is the time that we take to give back to God. Would you pray with me? Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the many blessings that you've given us. We're thankful, Father, especially for the gift of your Son, through whom we have the hope of eternal life. We pray that as we give back to you, that we'll do so cheerfully, that the work here might continue and the gospel might spread. Be with us in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a few announcements for this church family, people we need to be in prayer for. Patrick Edwards' father is home after heart surgery, but he is developing a cough. And so we're being asked to pray specifically that that will not develop into pneumonia, which would be very dangerous. So let's remember Patrick Edwards' father in our prayers. Janet Havenhill will have knee surgery tomorrow, and Caden Henserling will have some surgery tomorrow as well. Let's remember them in our prayers. In the good news department, Caroline Hargrove is home and doing well after her surgery, and so we thank God for that. There is an elders and deacons meeting immediately after services, so make your way back there for that meeting. And finally, there are calendars on the information table. These are the magnetic calendars that you can put on your fridge, and they have all the important dates for the next year, VBS, youth lectures, winter singing, all the things like that, so you can plan your year. Be sure and pick those up. Those are all the announcements I have. If I've missed anything, if you'll let me know, we'll get that announced later. We'll get it out on the wire. If you'll be standing, we'll be dismissed in prayer by James Hinton.
Let us pray. Our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful for this day. It is indeed good that we've been able to come together to offer up our worship to you, to sing praises, to hear your word, and to remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, we ask that as we go throughout the beginning of this week, that we'll remember this lesson and impart it into our lives, to open our hearts to a true repentance, to a true change, to turn away from anything that has separated us from you. Father, we pray for those that have been mentioned this morning that need our prayers, those that are suffering from illnesses, those that are about to have surgeries, and we're so very thankful, Father, for the surgeries that have come through well. Father, we ask that you'll be with us as we depart. We ask that you forgive us of our sins as we show that true repentance within. We pray all these things in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's most holy name. Amen.